Hi guys, and welcome to another Watch Geek video. Now just as the title says, I bought a Rolex. And this is gonna be one of those fake unboxings, because when I buy these more expensive watches, I have to open the box in front of the courier to confirm that I got the watch that I ordered. So I actually had some time to spend with the watch, but still not enough to make a full review. So a full review will follow after this, but this is just an unboxing and first impressions for you guys. So let's open the box and see what I got. And here we go. I got the Rolex 36 Explorer, or the Explorer 1. This is the reference 114270 that was in production between years 2000 and 2010. This replaced the 14270 that was in production from, I believe, 1990 to 2000. And this one has a few improvements, including the movement that went to a pretty modern Rolex caliber 3130 and replaced the old 3000 caliber. Now, the 3130 was up until recently still in use in the Submariner No Date and the Oyster Perpetual models. So this is a pretty modern movement. Now, these have been updated in 2010 with that hideous 214270 Mark 1 that had the short hands from the 36 and an increased case, the 39, which was then replaced, I believe, in 2013 or something like that, with the 214270 Mark II that got the proportions right. Now, I was torn between getting this, which is the 36mm, and the new 39mm Mark II, but I had the pleasure of holding that 39mm in my hands, and somehow the balance and the proportions were just not right. That thing is bigger, it's kind of shorter, but this bezel is a lot thicker. I don't know, it just kind of doesn't work the way, I mean, it didn't look the way I expected it to. So I decided to get this one. Now, this is actually used, and I got it with no box, no papers, but I got a pretty good deal on it. And I would like to extend my gratitude to the seller, and I'll leave the link in the description. He's from Poland, and I bought this from Chrono24, and I was surprised, but I mean, not surprised, but he exceeded my expectations, because he said the watch is in perfect condition, and when the watch is 18 years old, and this one is from 2004, so it's slightly less, you expect at least hairline scratches or something like that, but this, when it came out, it was pretty, like, no scratches whatsoever. Now, I did wear it for a couple of days, so I do expect by the time I'm doing a review, this is gonna be full of scratches, especially this nicely polished side, because I do expect to wear this. Now, like I said, I got this 36 because the balance and the proportions of the dial, of the bezel, of the case, the lugs, everything is kind of perfect. Now, I'm the first guy who hates people when they say a watch is too small or a watch is too big. So for my wrist, I like this more. Maybe you prefer 39 if you have slightly larger wrists, or you have tastes that where you like larger watches. So for me, there is no watch that is too small or too big. There is just a watch that's right for you. Just like shoes. Imagine if we all had just one size of the shoe. Somebody would find them perfect, but most people would not be satisfied. So this is the 36. So my first impressions. First of all, I didn't expect it to be this small. It really, I mean, you always watch these videos and people say how it has a lot of wrist presence and everything. And yes, it does. It looks beautifully on my wrist, which I'm gonna show you in a couple of minutes. But it kind of, when I took it out of the box, it appeared very small. Like, I'm used to my Seiko 5, which is 37 millimeters, and it looks a lot larger than this. This looks almost like a 34 next to this 37 millimeter. However, once you put it on your wrist and you realize that it's a lot longer than the Seiko and the way it follows the curvature of the wrist, you kind of get used to it. And now I find it to be perfectly sized. So let's put it on my wrist to see how it looks. This, being the older styled, I mean, the old-fashioned Rolex, does come with a stamped clasp, and that's another thing that kind of surprised me. But first, let's do the wrist shot, and then we'll go back to the bracelet. There. Now look at the proportions on my wrist. Isn't that perfect? Look. I'm sure I could wear the 39, but I doubt it would look like this. I never like watches that go all the way to the edge of my wrist. I like them to be inside my wrist, like placed in the middle and slightly inwards. I don't like it when they're all the way there. And this looks just the way I love my watches to look on the wrist. And it's incredibly comfortable. Now, like I said, compared to the 14270, this got the updated movement, but also the updated bracelet, where you got the solid end links, and these side links are solid while the middle ones are hollow. You still have the same, not the same, but very similar stamped clasp. And now, I did expect this to be a bit jingly and to be in the level of a Seiko 5. However, it is not. Yes, it is almost the same construction, but it is much better built. It doesn't have the same rattle, the feeling of flimsiness. I still love these bracelets, they're very comfortable. And this one doesn't have it. Now, I expect that the 14270 is more similar to this than this one is. This is really an improvement. I mean, I was expecting and I was preparing for the worst, you know, getting an old style Rolex bracelet that's really not that good. And it's not on the same, not even close to the same level of the modern bracelets and clasps. But I'm very, very positively surprised. It really exceeded my expectations. Maybe it's down to me expecting it to be a really like rubbish, but it's really not. It's really comfortable, it's securely on the wrist, and it feels great. Another thing that this thing has that the 14270 doesn't is Superluminova. Although even on the 14270, some older models I believe got Superluminova, but others had tritium, meaning that the lume will fade over time. And because on this reference, the 3, 6, and 9 are painted white, so this is not lume, this is actually white paint. If you get the tritium ones, the older 14270, the markers and the hands are gonna start getting that yellow color as the tritium develops patina, but this is always gonna stay brilliant white. So if that's something that's gonna bother you, you're better off getting this, the 14270, because this one has Superluminova. So everything is gonna stay brilliant white, or it's actually more like cream white for the entire life of the watch. Now the other impressions, I love the protruding crystal. I love the curvature of the case. It's not slab-sided like the Rolex Submariner. It's just so beautiful. Every line is there, like perfectly placed and perfectly executed. And I have to admit, this watch really exceeded my expectations. I really do love it. When it comes to other technical details, it's 36 by, I believe, 45 millimeters. It's only 11 point something thick. Comes with a screwing crown, 100 meters water resistance, white gold markers and hands, and this beautiful glossy dial. Now, the Explorer has been on my radar for quite some time because it's one of the least blingy Rolexes, if you want to say it like that. And I know a Submariner is something that everyone wants to have, but this really flies under the radar. When you put it on your wrist, you know what you're wearing, but from a distance, it just looks like an ordinary black dialed watch. And that's something I actually love. Anyways, I really do love this watch and I really enjoy wearing it. Still, I do not find it as pretty as my Reverso. That thing is still the king of my collection. But it's still very impressive. Now, I will be doing a full review, like I said, after I spend some time with the watch, wear it, see how it behaves. But overall, so far, I'm pretty impressed. And there's another thing. I just accidentally discovered that by getting this watch, I almost developed a perfect 3-watch collection. Now, my collection is much larger and I have watches that I will never sell, like my King Seiko, my Seiko Laurel, and all those different models. The Sturmansky chronograph, the Amphibia. All those watches have a story and I really need them in my collection to be happy. But if you're just an ordinary guy looking for 3 perfect watches for a perfect 3-watch collection, I'll just show you how was that when I was looking at my box, I realized, well, look, an average person who's not a watch maniac and doesn't need to have a million watches can have these 3. have all the bases covered, and have respect not just from ordinary people, but from real watch geeks. So I have my G-Shock DW5000, which is like the timeless design, and I believe it's like a Submariner of digital watches. It's iconic, and this is a screwback edition, meaning that you get instant respect from G-Shock lovers. You have the Reverso as a dress option, a real horological masterpiece that's 100 years old in design. So this is, some brands are not even 100 years old, and this is coming close to being 100 years old as a model. The design is iconic, and I still find it to be one of the prettiest watches ever made. And so this is a dress option for getting out to dinner, you know, wearing a suit. And then you have this as an everyday watch. So this for sports and activity and working, like if you're working around your house, around your yard, this for a nice evening out, and this as an everyday business watch. So all three cover all the bases and are so brilliant and so respected that, like I said, you're not just gonna impress, I mean, you're probably never gonna impress anyone else who's not into watches, because we watch people like to think people look at our wrists, but the truth is, they're not. But if you get these three watches and walk wherever there is a watch geek, they're gonna be impressed. Anyways, that's it. So my perfect three watch collection, that's actually about 12 watches that I'm never gonna get rid of, but who cares? Anyways, that's it. So thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed. If you did, please like and subscribe. And until the next video, bye.